News 25 is brought to you by J.K. Nelson Law, 727-9900 today. If you need a lawyer, you need Nelson.
Tonight, the county ponders more traffic control devices and birthday greetings continue while social distancing. News 25 starts now.
This is News 25 with Deanna O'Donnell. News 25, local coverage you can count on.
County commissioners decide if certain intersections need more stop signs. It's Thursday, April 30th. I'm Deanna O'Donnell. Well, just days after two serious crashes earlier this month, Nye County commissioners asked Director of Public Works Tim Dahl to take a closer look at those intersections and consider converting them to four-way stops. We're talking about the intersections of Homestead and Thousandaire and Charleston Park and Barney. Tuesday, Dahl told commissioners that based on available data, that is unlikely to happen, but he's considering other changes to improve safety at those intersections.
In talks with our consultant, it's not recommended that we do actual warrant, four-way stop warrants at those intersections because there's not been a lot of accidents at those intersections, although there has been some. And the traffic counts are significantly lower right now due to the majority of people trying their best to not travel so much and stay at home. So the consultant fears that that warrant would not come back to warrant a four-way stop at those intersections. So consequently, I'm going to do what I can, and that is to put out some rumble strips at those intersections to try to give people a better idea that there's a feeling of, hey, there's something going on here. We need to slow down and take a look. We'll do some early stop warnings, such as a stop sign ahead. And then we also have the ability to change out those stop signs to an LED surrounding or bordered stop sign, which has become something that has been very effective at our other intersections, or I'd like to think so. No accidents is a really good sign. So we're going to try a couple of those at those intersections and see if we can't help people get the message that there is a stop there and it's important for them to pay attention.
Well, as we told you last night, mail-in ballots have already been sent out to Nevada voters. That caught some candidates by surprise. Concern now that ballots may be returned before they have time to campaign for votes. But as Nye County Clerk Sandra Merlino explains, just because you get your ballot early doesn't mean you have to send it back right away.
The thing is they don't have to be returned right away. Just because the ballots are mailed out does not mean any voter has to vote them. They can still wait until the last minute. As long as they're postmarked by June 9th, they will be counted within 7 days after we receive them. And, it's a difficult time for the candidates because of the social distancing and everything else. There are no candidates nights. Everybody has to rely on social media or mail. So I really feel for them. But unfortunately, because we had to switch to an all-mail election, we had to do it immediately. Once we decided to do it, we had to make the decision and get things done. Right now, a person can still mail in a voter registration to us up until May 12th. They can also show up in office, which is a little difficult. We're actually opening starting Monday just for that. If somebody has a voter registration, we'll have a table out there and they can knock on the door and submit it. But that's only until May 12th. Now, they can do all of this online. They can go on the Secretary of State's website and update their registration, change their address, or even register right now. But we do have a period after May 12th that they can still register online up until May 22nd, only online, or change address or party or anything else. After May 22nd, we have in-person registration only, which is a new bill that passed in the legislature. So what that does is starting May 23rd, which is the first day of early voting, individuals have to show up in person, show ID in order to get a ballot and vote, and they will be given what's called a provisional ballot at that time. All same-day registrants will be given a provisional ballot. Once that ballot is vetted throughout the whole state, then we will count that vote. There are many people who are uncomfortable about putting their ballot back in the mail, even though it's postage paid, it's ready to go, it's no cost to them. Some people feel better about turning it in person. That is fine, but I want to caution everyone, you can only turn in your ballot unless you can turn it in for an immediate family member, but there has to be express permission and an affidavit signed. So you can't just go pick up your neighbor's ballots and bring them in. You can only turn in your ballot.
So the Knight County Clerk's Office is open officially on Monday, and they will be registering people, changing addresses, and changing your party. So if you want to contact them here or in Tonopah, you can do so, and they will be having some kind of customer service happening there. We'll be right back right after this break.
News 25 is brought to you by Star Nursery, your garden's partner for every bloomin' thing.
Welcome back. Well, the Federal Reserve remains ready to react to the economic effects of COVID-19. Small business owners are finding it easier to get hardship loans, and workers at some of the nation's largest companies prepare for a midday walkout. Angela Miles joins us now with the details.
Tapping our news, Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell warns the U.S. economy will need more monetary support to recover. Yesterday, Powell told reporters the Fed will keep interest rates close to zero due to the sharp decline in economic activity. The Fed projects the pandemic will continue to weigh heavily on the economy, employment, and inflation in the near term. Small business owners are finally getting better relief. Bank industry groups say changes by the Small Business Administration are making it easier for banks to lend money to thousands of small business owners who submitted applications. A May 1st walkout is planned by workers at several corporations, including Walmart, Amazon, and FedEx. The workers want better safety standards and hazard pay as they stay on the job during the pandemic.
To find out where you can see us every day, go to businessfirstam.com.
Thanks, Angela. Well, some very caring family and friends got together last night to wish an 80-year-old veteran a very special happy birthday.
We are here on Chowchilla Circle, our friend down the road here. It's his 80th birthday. The whole neighborhood's getting together, and since COVID-19's out, we're going to do a drive-by happy birthday. Everybody decorated their vehicles. And it's going to be a really good time for him. He turns 80. He's going to come outside. We'll do a drive-by, go down to the end of the circle, go across the street, and we'll all sing him happy birthday.
Johnson called me and said he would like to get everybody's phone number because he would like to have them all come meet down at the street corner and for us to come out here about 6:25. So we sat at the edge of the driveway because, you know, he would have been too suspicious. So he had no clue that this was going to happen.
Who doesn't?
You're wondering why your wife wanted you to sit outside?
Yeah. Because I didn't want to come out here.
But you're happy.
As much as I can be, yeah.
80 years old.
Happy 80th.
Thank you.
Happy birthday again, Wes. Well, Knight County had one new positive COVID-19 test result reported Wednesday here in Pahrump. That brings Knight County's positive test result totals to 37 countywide. That is of the people who have been tested, which currently lists 1,005 tests. Pahrump has 31 positive tests with 14 people recovered. Tonopah, 4 people who tested positive with 2 listed as recovered. Amargosa and Beatty both have 1 positive test result, and that one, both in both places, recovered. Well, the famous Air Force Thunderbirds are giving us a fantastic look at their recent flyover of Las Vegas. The video released by the Air Force takes us inside the cockpits of the F-16 Fighting Falcons.
Tower Thunderbird 1, ready for takeoff, right 3 left.
Roger, clear for takeoff, 3 left. Wind, calm. Contact departure, good day.
Thunderbird 1, clear for takeoff, runway 3 left. Thunderbirds, push 6.
Yeehaw! We'll be taking off for the Las Vegas flyover! Las Vegas flyover, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8!
Roger, Thunderbird 1's airborne, passing 3,500 for 5,000.
Go, babies! Return!
For our radio listeners, that was the Fighting Falcons flying over Las Vegas. So if you want to see that video, you can go on our local Facebook page, or you can even hook up to a local TV or watch us on YouTube as well. And is it too late for me to become a fighter pilot? Because that looks super exciting. We'll be right back with more news right after this.
This segment of the news is brought to you by Mountain West Lawyers, Nye County's injury attorneys. Don't get bullied by insurance companies. Call Jason Ernest and bully them back at 775-727-9500.
Well, COVID-19 has everyone on edge, especially people with chronic medical conditions. Meet a mother from Ohio with multiple sclerosis who expected the worst after testing positive for the virus. Erica Foreman has her story of hope and survival.
40-year-old Renee English has been living with multiple sclerosis for nearly 20 years. So when she woke up with a pounding headache, she thought it was a side effect from treatment.
I really thought, oh my gosh, something's terrible happening with my MS because I just had my medication.
The mother of two also developed a fever, sore throat, and ear pain.
So it was like strep on steroids, and I felt at the same time the ear pain was just, it was piercing. It was horrible.
Renee's doctor sent her to Cleveland Clinic's COVID-19 drive-through test site, and then she got a call she'll never forget.
She said, well, you're not feeling well because you did test positive for COVID-19. I immediately couldn't speak. I was in tears.
Renee's MS also began to flare, with numbness in her face and hands, which doctors say is common when someone with MS has a fever.
I went over her MS symptoms with her and explained that she was not experiencing an MS relapse, but the coinciding infection with COVID-19 was increasing her MS symptoms.
With her fever in a safe range and no trouble breathing, Renee recovered at home, taking acetaminophen, plenty of fluids, and lots of rest.
It was a solid 2 weeks before I felt like myself again. And then I would say it was another whole week after that before I stopped being so incredibly tired.
Renee's recovery hasn't been a slam dunk. She lost her sense of taste and smell and has lingering numbness in her face and hands. But she wants others to know COVID-19 is beatable.
I would say to most people who are, you know, if you're healthy and active and you get it, you're going to be okay. I'm living proof. You know, I have MS and I was terrified. My first thought was, oh my God, I'm going to be on a ventilator. I'm not going to survive this. And I think those of us who survive need to do everyone a service by coming out and saying, you know, you can survive.
At Cleveland Clinic, I'm Erica Foreman.
Thanks so much, Erica. Well, Jim Marchand is a candidate for Nevada's 4th Congressional District, which includes a large portion of central Nevada, plus all of Nye County and the northern area of Clark County. Today, Stephen Horsford represents that district, but Marchand says he's picked up some key endorsements and hopes to soon be able to represent the people of Nevada's 4th District in Washington.
Everything's going well with my campaign. I've recently been able to announce that Congressman Jim Jordan has endorsed my campaign. That goes along with Congressman Andy Biggs and Congressman Gosar. They are the leaders in the House Freedom Caucus. And for those of you that don't know, the House Freedom Caucus is made up of about 40 members, and they are the most conservative fighters in our Congress right now. So I am proud to be endorsed by them. CD4, well, of course, gun rights is a huge issue for CD4, and I was rated the only one running in this race that has been rated by NRA, A-plus rated. I've also been endorsed by Nevada Firearms Coalition for this race, and so that's a huge issue for me. Also, immigration is a huge issue for me. I think we ought to put people in Congress that support President Trump's Build the Wall policy and fix our immigration system once and for all. My background is I'm an entrepreneur businessman all my life. I retired in 2003. I was in the technology industry. I had a computer software company, an internet service provider company, and then retired off of a voice over IP phone company and moved out to Las Vegas in 2005 and immediately got involved with the state and local Republican parties. And just got involved in politics. And then in 2015, our own government passed the largest tax increase in Nevada history, and it included the commerce tax, one of the most dreadful types of taxes you can assess on a business. And it made me mad. So I decided to run. I ran for assembly for District 37 over in Las Vegas, and I won and served in that session. And I was ranked by Matt Slapp's American Conservative Union, the number one most conservative voting legislator in the assembly for that session. So I'm real proud of that. And also Nevada Policy Research Institute, they ranked me number two. So I've proven that I am a conservative, and I have a voting record to prove it. And I'm one of the only ones, actually, I'm the only one that's running right now that has the experience to run in Congress or serve in Congress right now, because, you know, all of my opponents are fine people, but they haven't had the experience yet. I'm the only one that's run and that has been able to earn those ratings. I was 100% rated by Nevada Right for Life, and they have endorsed me for this for my run here for Congress. So that's the key point I'd like to get across, is experience matters. You need somebody that has a record, a proven record, and I have that. You can go to my website at jimmarchant.com. It's JimMarchant.com all together. You can call me at 702-305-7475, and my email is jim@jimmarchant.com. It's all pretty easy.
News 25 WeatherCam is brought to you by Lerner & Rowe Injury Attorney's Office in Pahrump. In a wreck, need a check? Call 702-877-1500.
All right, and if you are a candidate and you want to get an interview here on our news, just give us a call, 775-727-9400, extension 201, or you can email me, Deanna@kpvm25.tv. Let's take a look outside right now and see what's happening. Just clear blue skies. We're going to find out what's in store for your weather right after this.
News 25 weather is brought to you by Dairy Council of Nevada. The splash of cream in your coffee, the dollop of sour cream on your burrito, the melted toasty cheese on your pizza. Undeniably delicious, undeniably dairy. Enjoy what's real. We'll be right back.
Hello and welcome back to News 25. I'm Michael Donohue with today's weather. In Las Vegas, we saw a high of 99 degrees, a low of 70. Death Valley, 107, their low is 77. 95, a low of 62 in Amargosa. Beatty, 91, their low is 61 degrees. 81.49 in Goldfield. 78.48 in Tonopah. 72.44 in Carson City. 80, a low of 46 in Fallon. And 77 with a low of 47 up in Fernley. Now today in Pahrump, we saw sunny skies. Our high today was 94 degrees. Winds out of the south-southwest up to 15 miles per hour. 15% humidity, and our sunrise at 5:51 this morning. Now for tonight, continuing on with some nice clear skies, our low is going to be 62 degrees. It is 92 outside currently with winds out of the southeast up to 8 miles per hour. Humidity at 27% and 7:31 tonight for our sunset. Now looking into that 7 day, we're pretty much just going to be seeing some mostly sunny skies on Saturday and Tuesday, but really just some sunny skies pretty much throughout the week. We're still going to be dealing with those high winds just at around 11 and 12 miles per hour from tomorrow through Monday. Now looking at our temperatures, we're pretty much going to start that climb here again soon. From Friday to Monday, we're going to be hanging out in those high 80s between 87 and 89 degrees. Then on Tuesday, we're going to be hitting those low 90s between 90 and 93 from next Tuesday through Thursday. Our overnights, we're looking at a very similar pattern. On Friday and Saturday, we're going to be seeing lows of 60 degrees down to 58 on Sunday and Monday. Then back up into those low 60s from Tuesday to Thursday, between 60 and 64 degrees there. And so now with that, we're going to throw it back to the desk with Deanna.
All right, and we do have Governor Steve Sisolak's live stream that's happening right now, reposted on our Facebook page if you'd like to see that. We'll be back here tomorrow night with more news. Good night.